We're here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from Nathan Beard, who writes, "Hi, Mo. Love, love, love your site, style of writing, and expertise. I'd love to see an article on the best games to come through Kickstarter."
Well, Nathan, here we have the first step, a podcast topic on the best games to come through Kickstarter that probably should eventually lead to an article on the blog if I ever get a little bit more caught up, but at least you'll get the conversation here.
So the best games to come through Kickstarter is a pretty broad net to cast. This could mean our favorite games, the highest rated games on Board Game Geek that were from Kickstarter, but also even games itself is a bit vague since I've backed far more RPGs myself than board games on Kickstarter. And if you include zines, I'm pretty sure there have been a lot more RPGs released than board games on Kickstarter.
Yeah. Oh, it's true. So in order to narrow things down, what we're going to go with are games that funded on Kickstarter specifically, not other crowdfunding platforms, that we think are sweet. Without any consideration of things like, should this game have been Kickstarter? Was Kickstarter used the way it was intended? Was it fulfilled on time? Did backers complain? We're not looking at all of that. All we are looking at is the finished product. We are looking at great games we love that happen to have gone through the Kickstarter process.
Now, I think there's a lot more to this topic that is worth talking about. So I convinced Mo to do a follow-up episode. Should these games have been on Kickstarter? Do games really benefit from Kickstarter? Are crowdfunded games better than non-crowdfunded games? Is most of the physical product coming through Kickstarter utter garbage?
So be sure to join us next week, which we record on January the 24th, right here on Twitch, twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop. So we can hear your outrage in the chat room as we are recording.
All right. Well, now on to the list, which as usual is in no particular order.
Yeah, this is, if you want some insight into the psyche of Mo, just look at the order the list come in, because I always do it as the things pop into my head. And the first game that popped into my mind when asked this question isn't really one game, but it is one game, but more importantly, a publisher and a line of games that wouldn't exist without Kickstarter, and that is the Valeria games from Daily Magic Games. Now, I discovered them at Origins, had nothing to do with Kickstarter. I went by their booth. It was very purple and they offered me free nerds to try a game and I was sold on the game. But that game was Valeria Card Kingdoms, which was originally a Kickstarter. And it was their first Kickstarter. And every single Valeria game and expansion since has been initially funded through Kickstarter. That is their system for releasing games.
At this point, there isn't a Valeria game we haven't enjoyed, and we've played almost all of them. We still have a soft spot in our hearts for the original. We love the three-game small box series, especially Thrones of Valeria, and we're itching to get our hands onto Castellans of Valeria in its final form while we currently explore Guild Academies of Valeria.
Yes, and except for the brand dilution by having so many different games named Valeria, they are all separate games. There are expansions for some of them, they are all separate games. We love them. Like Valeria is up there with Grand Gamers Guild for, you know, things we talk about. Valeria, Garinto, and Aventuria are probably the holy trinity of games that we are always talking about on the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Because we don't talk about Azul anymore. It used to be Azul. Before Garinto, it was Azul.
Before Garinto. We could probably say that the Garinto Jones Theory d'Azul out of our game recommendation list. Next up, I've got a hidden gem. This popped in my head because when I first heard the topic, of course, all the big games, which we are going to talk about some of them tonight, popped in my head. But I'm like, what's some of the ones people may not know were Kickstarter, or even more so, don't know at all? And the game that came to me then was Chiseled by Michael Epstein. Now, this was originally Kickstarted by Michael's own company, Copper Frog Games, and was later picked up by our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, that actually helped with the fulfillment and actual publication of the game. Now, this is a deck-shedding card game that does a fantastic job of matching its theme. Your deck is your hunk of rock, and you're going to use tools to carve away parts of that deck, hopefully leaving you with the perfect sculpture that at least satisfies the critics somewhat. There'll be three randomly drawn critics that are going to judge your work.
Now, this game has been a huge hit with everyone we've introduced it to and is in regular public play rotation. Now, while as a small box game, I often don't think about it. I really have never had a bad play of this game, even when taking huge risks with chainsaws.
Next, I have Fleet from the team of Benjamin Pinchback and Matthew Riddle, who I don't want to, in the who's who of board gaming, that's a pair of names that you will eventually get to know. If you're a hobby gamer, you're going to be like, oh, it's that group. They make great games. Now, they kickstarted Fleet along with Eagle Griffin Games. This is the game. This was their first big success. Pinchback and Riddle put out and was a huge hit and put them on the map. And that made a huge splash. And they have been releasing multiple games since then. But of all their games that I've currently played, Fleet is still one of my favorites. This is a fantastic card-driven economic game that Matt Riddle fully admitted it. We stole the Power Grid auction system and threw it in our game because we love it. But uses it to great effect. It's a perfect mix of long-term planning and having to react to what your opponents are doing, which could totally mess up that long-term planning. Now, there's expansions. There's Wharfside, and there's other versions like Fleet the Dice Game. I still love the base game. Now, personally, it's one of those games where I spent money to upgrade it because my fish are no longer blue cubes. They're little wooden fish.
All right. Well, then you have Gloomhaven, which has been kickstarted multiple times. Now, Mo bit the bullet on one of the later printings, second or third. We don't even remember which one it was.
And then we
played the game for more than a year, almost every week, and still never came close to finishing it.
As far as I know, it could have been like the next scenario was the end, but it sure didn't feel like it. This is one I want to get back to. The COVID pandemic hit, then KTOR had a kid. We got to find a new acronym for them. KTOR. Maybe it's KTOR. Yes, the couple Deanna and I were playing Gloomhaven with had a baby, and they're still in new parent land and probably will be there for a while. This game just like it wasn't just us. This rocketed up the Board Game Geek rankings, spent a number of months at number one. It's currently still, I don't know if it's two or three, but it's in the top three. Like you can't deny Gloomhaven being one of the best games to come out of Kickstarter. Like if we were ranking this list, it would probably be number one.
No, it's a fantastic cooperative dungeon crawler with a surprising amount of meat on it and a lot of Euro mechanics. Not only a great game, but it set the bar for the amount of content you get in one board game box, replayability, and box sizes. Now, many games have tried to recreate its success, and none have yet to really pull it off.
No, nothing has compared. I do keep hearing good things about Tainted Grail, though, but it definitely didn't make the hype plunge or, you know, not getting the talk that Gloomhaven ever did. Going way back. In the early days of Kickstarter, first couple of years, you have one of the first dice placement games that was ever published, and that is Alien Frontiers. This is one I didn't get into right away, but I had a friend who jumped in on it. It was their first back Kickstarter, and at the time, it was one of those where they'd show up with the game, and everyone would be like, you did what? What, you gave them money to help produce it? Like Kickstarter was so new, you're like, what are you doing? And you're throwing your money away, and sure enough, this game showed up. And it was solid, really solid. That friend kept up with all the future releases and Kickstarters. I finally jumped in and bit the bullet myself with the fourth printing of the game. That was a Kickstarter that included a new printing of the base game with some improvements as well as all the previous expansions. Then there were multiple Kickstarters after that. There was an essential edition and there was a fifth printing and then a big box. And there was the Rocket Dice fiasco that happened in the middle of there, which I'm not going to dwell on. This is another one, though, that honestly, I got not the big box, but I got the set with all the expansions, with all the factions and everything. And honestly, I'd rather just play the base game.
There's a new edition of Alien Frontiers called Alien Frontiers Edition X, which was quietly released last year. It includes an all-new expansion called the Data Core. Interestingly, this new version doesn't seem to have been crowdfunded.
Yeah, it's odd.
Now, we love this sci-fi themed game with its elegant mechanics and combination of area majority, take that, and exception-based technologies.
And one small comment on Kickstarter, actually, at this point, I didn't know this existed until doing research for this particular episode, that there was an Edition X. So I don't know if that says something about not kickstarting the game and no one hearing it, but I definitely hadn't until now. So I almost completely forgot that my number one game of all time, Anachrony, was originally Kickstarted. It was the first game. Second. It's the second game from Mind Clash Games. They got their start on Kickstarter with Tricurion, Legends of Illusion. And from then on, they've been using Kickstarter to fund new games and still have them up today. Right now, they're going through the Perseverance series of games through Kickstarter. Now, Anachrony, as I mentioned, is my top game of all time. I really love that game. And I recently reinvested in it. It's one of the few games that I bothered to buy a second time because of a more recent Kickstarter. And that was for what they called the Infinity Box. This was a updated version of the game, like an updated rule book, combination of deluxe components, new scenarios, a new, totally new solo way to play, and a giant box that fit everything with game trays inserts. And it's one of the most expensive Kickstarters I ever backed, and I don't regret it at all. Though I do wish we got an Anachrony to the table more often.
This is a game that seems super overwhelming, but that onboards you by presenting very few valid options at the start of the game. Now, those options quickly branch out into a wealth of options and valuable strategies. And yes, this is the time travel game where you send yourself resources from the future, but risk a paradox if you don't remember to send themselves back to yourself when you get to the future you sent them from.
Next, I have the Duke. Maybe we have four games that we always proselytize about. The Duke was originally funded on Kickstarter way back in 2012. Did people even realize Kickstarter was around that long ago? This is one I did not Kickstart. I picked up the game from our friendly local game store, the Catalyst Games version, and I had no clue it was a Kickstarter until I opened up the copy. And on the back of the game board is a list of backers being thanked for Kickstarting it. And I'm like, oh, cool. I guess it's a Kickstarter game. And at that point, I knew Kickstarter was a thing, but like I wasn't following it. Now, we've talked about the Duke on the show a ton. We both love the Duke. And honestly, I've been praising it since it came out. Now, most of the stretch goals that were in the original Kickstarter became the expansion packs you can buy. So I never felt like I missed out on anything by not backing the Kickstarter here, because I did pick up all the stuff eventually.
Now, interestingly, for the second printing, Catalyst skipped crowdfunding completely and just released the Duke Lord's Legacy, which had some of the original content as well.
Next is the game that put Stonemaier Games on the map. Viticulture, that was Jamie's first published game, and honestly, still one of his best, in my opinion. It is a fantastic winemaking worker placement game that did a good job integrating its theme right into the mechanics.
Now, Stonemaier, of course, went on to crowdfund a number of other games, though eventually Jamie changed his mind on Kickstarter and crowdfunding in general, and now has a steady stream of releases coming direct from Stonemaier Games.
Now, another winemaking game is Vinhos Deluxe Edition from Eagle Griffin, who were honestly early adopters of Kickstarter. I looked this up, right? And I'm like, oh, wow, okay, that was Kickstarter. And I look, and they've launched stuff under Eagle Games, and they've launched stuff under Griffin Games. And if you add up the number of projects between both of them, they have launched 100 Kickstarter projects. I had no clue Eagle Griffin was that active on Kickstarter. Now, Fleet, I mentioned earlier, was from them. But I wanted to call out this one because this shows off what companies have done with Kickstarter to take a game that was successful, that was popular, that certain groups of gamers liked, and make it explode. Like, they take the designer and artist and improve everything about the game. The fact that it looks better, it's got better components, it has more clear rules, it has more variants. The deluxe edition of Vinhos, like, destroys the original. Even more so, they even included the original rule set for people who liked the original still and didn't want the new rule changes. So I wanted to call out Vinhos Deluxe.
Any more Kickstarter is pretty much a pre-order system for Eagle Griffin, and also the way all Ian O'Toole and Vital Lacerda games get released anymore. Inventions being the most recent, and we, of course, backed Weather Machine, which we all really enjoyed, but need to get to the table again.
Next, I have Clans of Caledonia. This is a heavier economic game set in the Scottish Highlands that kind of looks like a Kickstarter game just because the sheer amount of wood in the game. There is a ton of components on this one. Now, I discovered Clans through my friend Neil, who did back the original Kickstarter. This is one of my favorite economic games of all times, probably because it features a huge amount of asymmetry. At one point, this was like the heavy game we were playing every weekend, every event, physically. Then we discovered it on Board Game Arena.
We played a lot of games on BGA, and it was on repeat for a good part of a year with one game and another starting over and over again. There we learned how the different clans played and how your strategy had to adapt not only for your clan, but for what other clans the other players were playing.
Oh, yeah. You had to know we were going to bring this up. We've already mentioned it like three times, but now it's officially on the list. That is Garinto. If it wasn't for Garinto, I would have never have met Mark Spector or Grand Gamers Guild, our current sponsor. But that's not what I want to highlight about Garinto. It's not just because it made that bridge for us. I want to call it out because it's still one of the best abstract strategy games in my collection that happens to also feature fantastic components and a great table presence.
You draft and place tiles that let you collect more tiles. The more tiles you have in a color, the more powerful that element becomes and the more tiles you can draft with it. But watch the current scoring cards and make sure what you are grabbing is helping and not hurting your final score.
Yeah, we still love Garinto. It still sees regular play, both with my friends and family and local events. Like, honestly, getting to know Mark and Grand Gamers Guild is a sweet bonus, some sweet icing on the cake, but I would love Garinto either way.
Well, I love big, epic, sci-fi 4X games, and so far the best I have played is Eclipse Second Dawn for the Galaxy. Now, this one is interesting, as the original game wasn't a Kickstarter or crowdfunded in any way. Mo had a copy and raved about it, but I never got to try the original.
And you never will, because the original is out of my collection. The original was one of my top games of all time. At one point, back when I was running the Windsor Gaming Resource and the Pro Boards, it was my favorite game. I sold that, though, because I replaced it with Second Dawn, which was a colossal games Kickstarter, a pretty big one. This was a reboot of the original and a deluxe edition kind of all in one. They streamlined the rules, they improved the components, they included and refined the existing expansions, added new content, and of course put everything in a big shiny new box with fantastic game trays insert. Like, this would probably be my number one game if it got to the table more often. Next, I have the Brass games, Brass Lancashire and Brass Birmingham, which has a similar story to Eclipse, which is why it follows Eclipse, because I love Brass. I love it. It's one of the best Martin Wallace games I've ever played. It's one of the best pick-up and deliver games. It is a fantastic economic game back before the Kickstarter, back when it was very brown and orange. It was both one of the best games in my collections and the ugliest game in my collection at once. Then Roxley decided to reboot the game with a new look, a slight refinement in rules, which helps you if you've got a bad hand. There's a new rule where you can discard two matching cards to do an action. And a totally new edition, because they put out two games. There's Brass Birmingham, which is the game I love, just made pretty, with one little rule tweak, and Brass Lancashire, which is a totally new game using the same mechanics with new maps and a new resource, which everyone likes to joke about. That almost sold me. I was like, yeah, but I've got my copy of Brass. But then they also introduced the gaming world to what they call Iron Clays, gamer poker chips for hobby gamers. And they threw those in with the backing when you backed Brass, and that was it. I was in, all in. I actually got two sets of Iron Clays because I got them for both games, and I got both new printings.
Yeah, this one was a bit of a slow burn in the community, though. Yeah, there was a lot of buzz when the Kickstarter was announced, and when it delivered, there was more, but not a ton. People kept talking about the games, and more people tried them, and now Brass Birmingham is the number one game on Board Game Geek and has been for a better part of a year, I believe.
That's the one with
the new map and rules, and the original is still in the top 20.
Yeah, so one Kickstarter has two games in the top 20 on Board Game Geek. Like, it is fantastic. And the Iron Clays have their own entry. I don't know if they have a rank, but I still love those Iron Clays. What I need to do is I need to take them out and put them somewhere so we use them in other games. Next, I have Scythe. I already mentioned how Stonemaier got started with Viticulture, but I haven't called out Scythe, which was their most successful Kickstarter. And yes, I will say Viticulture put Stonemaier on the map, but it put it on like a small point on the map that only a few people knew about. Scythe is where the Jamie exploded. That's when everyone, the entire gaming industry, started taking notice. The game got into mass market stores. It is a fantastic game. Though this was the we were latecomers, like complete total latecomers to due to this one. It was an initial bad experience based on who I played with. Now, I remember it being on Kickstarter, though what I remember it being on Kickstarter was everyone going on about the art, not the game. It was all about the art and the setting.
Yeah, Scythe is getting quite old in board game terms, but you still hear people talking about it, including us. It's one of those games where we show a picture or mention playing it, and people come out of the woodwork to point out how big a fan they are. Now, while the core game hasn't seen an update since 2018, the series continues with a new sequel, Expeditions, which just showed up last weekend for Moe's birthday. So we're looking forward to checking that out soon.
All right, that's what we have for board games, but we are the Tabletop Bellhop, not the Board Game Bellhop. So that's actually not a bad name. We could have went with that. We talk all things tabletop, so I want to highlight some RPGs that came through. Now, as Sean mentioned, there are a ridiculous amount of RPGs that have gone through Kickstarter. Again, we are going with ones that we think are awesome that happen to be on Kickstarter. And I am going to start with the One Ring Second Edition from Freely Publishing. Now, I know the original One Ring, the first printing, the first edition came out. And one of the things that was like a highlight was it came with a dice tray with the unique dice, and it was in a sleeve and it looked kind of cool. I don't know what was going on at the time in my life. I wasn't playing RPGs or I was happy playing Warhammer, but I didn't really care. Now, I remember it got a lot of praise. Then you don't hear much, but then it was a real big splash in the TTRPG industry when it was announced that Free League would be taking over the license and relaunching a new edition, this time being crowdfunded on Kickstarter. Once that hit, now I started to really hear about the game. Now, at the time, I still wasn't really doing RPGs, or again, I might have been busy running something specific, so didn't back it. Now, thankfully, Free League reached out to us to ask if we were interested in reviewing the game, and sent me copies of the starter set and a DM screen and the rule book. And I'm blown away by this game. Like, this game is fantastic. Like, I don't want to start a whole bash on D&D thing, but this does Tolkien's Middle Earth so much better than what people tend to do with it in games like Dungeons and Dragons. It has all the shadow and the interactions and traveling, and it feels like a Tolkien game designed to recreate the Tolkien feel and not just a big combat system about beating up orcs. I am really looking forward to actually running this, but it looks fantastic. I'm still blown away by this game. Every time I pick it up and look at it, it just looks so beautiful.
Now, continuing on, we can pretty much say, well, just about anything from Free League. Between Alien the RPG, Forbidden Lands, and probably our favorite of theirs, Tales from the Loop, the RPG, not the board game.
Yes, yes. Yes. Tales from the Loop, I've read and played, so that's even better. I need to run that for some people. Tales from the Loop is also neat. They're one... was it One Die Engine? Now I can't remember what the name of their system is. Yeah, oh, I feel bad.
Yeah, One Die Engine.
It is One Die Engine? Okay, yeah. It is actually a really great system. Next, though, I am going to call out one that I haven't played, but I wanted to put it on the list because I think it's important, and that is Coyote and Crow. This is such a beautiful book that just deserved to be made. I know we're not supposed to be commenting on what things should and shouldn't be on Kickstarter, but this was using Kickstarter for what it's for. I am so glad to have this on my shelf, though I feel terrible talking about it because I haven't actually sat down to read it. I did flip through it, though. It's beautiful. But I don't even mind that I haven't played it. Like just donating to the cause in a way makes me feel good. We even did the buy an extra copy for someone in need pledge where you buy two copies of the game, you get one, and then they send the other to someone in need. This was just a very cool project to see crowdfunded.
Well, next up, we have Evil Hat Games, who have been using Kickstarter to publish their games for some time, and they make some fantastic ones. Games like Thirsty Sword Lesbians, Apocalypse Keys, and Blades in the Dark, which I think most people have to admit is a foundational work that has inspired so many others, as well as just being a solid game itself.
Yeah, the big one for me from Evil Hat, you might be able to see it behind me over my shoulder, is Fate Core. Fate made a huge mark in the TTRPG industry and with fellow RPG players. But Fate Core made waves. Like, Fate was big for a while, and people were talking about everyone. It felt for a bit there, for the year that came out, it was like every single person converted their system to Fate Core. And you're still feeling parts of that. I back this one. I all in back this one. I have every Fate Core book and like six different setting books and all of the different how to make stuff and Fate Core supers and all of that. Fate Core compared to the original Fate, going back to the original FUD system, looking at games like Caribus Club and the Dresden Files, it's like night and day. They managed to distill the Fate system down to something manageable, rules light, and fantastic while still having crunch, which is something. It's like the indie game with crunch. I love it. So much streamlining. And then, of course, they dumbed it down even more. Dumbed is probably the wrong word. Sorry. Simplified it even more with Fate Accelerated, which was also part of the Kickstarter, and you could buy for $5. This is a super rules light version of Fate. Like, what it did for Fate is huge.
Now, of course, this only scratches the surface and is a very small sample of great games to come out of Kickstarter, severely limited to just those games we have personally have experience with.
Yeah.
In the RPG sphere, for instance, Avatar is hard to ignore, being, you know, one of the top 10 earners of all time. Though I have no idea if it's a good game because we've never had it. Many, in fact, suggest it might not be the greatest game. But for all of its quality or not, it has certainly made Powered by the Apocalypse far more well-known to the world. Mm-hmm. As well, the new MCDM RPG is making a giant splash right now. And we've got a playtester for it in our chat room. Yep. Numenera put Monty Cook back on the map. And games like Far West gained notoriety for entirely the wrong reasons.
Yeah, and on the board game side of things, of course, the elephant in the room that we didn't mention a single game from would be Simon Games or Cool Mini or Not Games or whatever they want to be called now, which went from a Hot or Not style miniature rating site to one of the biggest publishers in board games in the world, all due to Kickstarter. Now, for the MFE, if you do want my recommendation, I almost put Rising Sun on the list tonight. But there's also other board games that set records, blew people away, games that people are still playing, stuff like Kingdom Death Monster, Cthulhu Wars, Tainted Grail, Nemesis, and honestly, even Exploding Kittens. That whole brand launched because of Kickstarter. That launched an empire of party games.
Well, there you have what we think of some of the best games to come out of Kickstarter. Now, what's the best game that you've played that was originally crowdfunded? Did you back it? Or did you pick it up after the fact? Let us know about it in the comments.
Or join us on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com, where I'm sure Sean would love to chat with you about the merits and flaws of Kickstarter back when it started and where it is now.
And now a word from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
This one actually ties in well with our last episode.
Love is in the air. You may just made last-minute reservation plans for a romantic dinner, only to find out you're in for a more puzzling experience. Now, game number 4 in the highly acclaimed holiday hijinks series, The Cupid Crisis, is a full 1-hour romantic escape room adventure in just 18 cards and a perfect way to spend your Valentine's Day with your gaming partner.
Yeah, we just reviewed this one last week after Deanna and I played it on a date night, biting the bullet and not playing it on Valentine's Day so we could share our thoughts with you in time to pick up a copy for yourself before the big day.
The Cupid Crisis is available as a single game, print and play, or part of a bundle at grandgamersguild.com, where you can use our exclusive code BELLHOP, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to save 10% on this or any of their other great games. And now it's time to check in with Lobby, our chat room here on Twitch. Hey, inmates.
Yes, hey, inmates. The inmates have been loud. They are going hoppies. That one's weird. Bell hoppies.
Bell hoppies. So I'm scrolling way back here.
Yeah, we got lots. We got lots to cover here.
A lot of chat here. So
as Sean's scrolling, look forward to a list of recommended games from Kickstarter from tabletop bellhop fans who we like to call the lobbyists, but are debating what their final name should be.
All right. So I'm going to start off here. Roger Dodger starts off with Obsession. Rocks
for good things. That is the Pride and Prejudice. I can't think of Jane Austen board game.
Followed by Distilled, which I think we'll all agree is a great one.
I couldn't decide if I put that on the list or not tonight. It was one of those when I was clearing out the Kallax behind me for last week. I was like, yeah, I probably should put Distilled on there. But everything we talked about were older games, and I decided to kind of stick with what we had. But yeah, it definitely could have been on the list. We are loving Distilled.
Eggman Jr.'s Raising Robots was a great Kickstarter.
That's one I don't know off the top of my head. If I looked it up, I'd probably look familiar.
Roger mentions Age of Comics looks good, and I agree. Oh, yes. Unfortunately, no one knows whether it's a great game or not, but it certainly looks solid.
So one quick side note. Anyone getting a list of these? I guess I can listen to Sean. Yeah. So I can put them in the show notes. I just realized I'm like, I should be typing these out as you're going. I'll just listen to it later. It's all good. Keep going.
All right. Age of Comics. Roger's reading on Fractured Sky, which looks really good.
That's not one I know again.
Math Guy Days has the Lazy DM's Forge of Foes for 5e. Nice. DCC Dying Earth. Immersive battle maps for tabletop role-playing games.
Cool. And the first thing I ever backed on Kickstarter were RPG battle maps.
And Humblewood.
Nice. No MCDM, MCDM, what is it? MCDM RPG? Is that it?
Roger,
oh, yeah, I got to jump back to Fractured Sky. Yeah. Those inserts are fantastic, like the player boards. Holy cow. And Deanna's looking at it too. Man, those player boards are awesome. I want Fractured Sky now.
Red Meeple Ryan mentioning Empires, Age of Discovery.
That one, if I remember, didn't do too good. There was an issue, if I remember.
In the Hall of the Mountain King from Eggman Jr.
I got to play. I saw that. Sorry, I saw that one at CD Realm before they moved. Mm. That one looked pretty good. More of a party game than I expected.
Heck, calling out, he backed Gorinto because of us.
Sweet. And he hated it. No, he loves it. I know he does. He's mentioned it before.
Eggman Jr. Townfolk Tussle is another good one. And Tenere's Adventures plus Arena.
Oh, that one looked good.
Another vote for Eclipse Second Dawn.
Oh, yeah.
And another vote for Second Dawn. Eggman saying Suburbia Collector's Edition. Yeah, say anything Suburbia is great.
Oh, I was so tempted. So tempted. Know what I don't like now? The new expansions are coming out require that. That's frustrating to me as someone who went all in on not only the second printing, but the new art, the original printing.
Title Blades Heroes of the Reef.
That was an interesting one. That's from the people who did, what is it? Zaya. Oh, Zaya should have been on my list. How did I not put Zaya on the list?
We haven't played Zaya in throw so that long. Up there.
That's it. Zaya, especially the second kit, we backed the first Kickstarter, and then we backed their second one, the Empires of a New Dawn or whatever there, that came with the spell sword and the new missions. Zaya should have been on my list. That was a complete omission. That's because the X part of my basement is still buried, and I didn't see it. Zaya should have been on the list.
Eggman mentioning Fire Tower. So fun.
That one looks neat. We got to see that at Origins.
Yeah, we saw that at Origins. Crusaders, Thy Will Be Done Deluxified.
Did that deliver? I know there were issues with that. That was Tasty Minstrel Games. It was kickstarted right when they were going under.
Mm.
I hope it did. More from Eggman, I'm screwing up with Tidal Force. Blades. Tidal Blades, I was thinking of Tavura as the game I was confusing with. Tidal Blades is not what I was thinking of, so not from the same people as Zaya.
Okay.
Cody Miller's the designer of Tavura. Sorry, that's me mixing things up.
But yeah, Eggman Jr. continues. The Grim Forest. Simple game, great production.
Our friend Ross backed that one, and I got to say, it looks good. I found the game a little lighter. I didn't need to own that one. I did try it. Deanna played it, actually, and I watched a game.
Ryan saying Steampunk Rally was his first Kickstarter back that got him onto Kickstarter. We all have our first mistake.
I've heard of that one. I don't know.
Raiders of the North Sea.
Oh, MCDM is on backer kit. There you go.
Okay. Raiders of the North Sea with playmat and expansions.
Oh, Raiders of the North Sea is good. That's one we bought. Bought that one. Love
Roger's
it.
Roger's pointing out Moonshine Empire, which was a big mistake in backing. Ooh.
We do have an episode about that. I don't want to go back to it again, but if anyone does want to hear about our biggest Kickstarter mistakes, we do have an episode you can find in our backlog.
Eggman Jr., Deluxe Dinosaur Island.
That game didn't satisfy.
It was kind of like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah, I went all in. I didn't get the Dulosaurus, but I got like the expansion and the base game. And I still have the Pogs downstairs. That was a Kickstarter stretch goal. I have the pogs from that game. The coins are really nice. Well, I've heard people say the enamel chips over time, but I didn't play it enough to see that. I don't know. I thought I was going to enjoy that game way more. Yeah, you played it with Ross, Deanna. Deanna played Grim Forest with Ross at Brimstone Games.
And Eggman says, finally, Champions of Midgard with Playmat and expansions.
I just sold that game. That is no longer in my collection.
Another vote for Eclipse.
So yeah, Eclipse, based on our chat room, Eclipse is the number one game to come out of Kickstarter, it seems.
Ryan's waiting for the next BT Kickstarter, Heroes 3 board games, and Hero Realms Dungeon Kickstarter.
Oh, I am looking forward to hearing people's feedback on Heroes. Heroes of Might and Magic 3. That's one I may regret not backing.
Ryan's favorite Kickstarter projects: Everdell Complete, BT Clan Invasion, BT Mercs, and the Networks.
The Networks was good. Yeah, Networks was good. That was, we won a copy of that game. Sean and Deanna technically won a copy of that game at a con during a play to win event.
Ryan backed Avatar, and apparently there have been screws ups in fulfillment.
Ooh, not good.
Dave mentions Shadow Dark, that probably deserves a mention in RPGs.
RPGs, I had more. I could have talked about Feng Shui 2, the Numenera Reliquary Box we backed. I used to back I almost should have put this on the list. Worldwide Wrestling, I backed twice. I backed the original printing of Worldwide Wrestling and the second edition.
Yeah, both of us backed Worldwide second time.
Mobile Frame Zero, like there's quite a few. The Roll Camera reprint, that's a good one. I didn't have to back that, but that's a good game. Like, there was lots. I have lots of Kickstarter games. Again, we were trying to do best of the best.
Yep.
Worldwide Wrestling, it isn't as big an admission as Zaya, but I think I should have called it out.
Yeah, I even thought about Worldwide Wrestling, but I'm like, I don't know.
I didn't care if it made a splash. I cared if I loved the game, and I did love the game.
Fair enough.
That's what I was going for. I didn't care if it was an important Kickstarter to the industry. I just cared if I'd like the game. Seas of Havoc, yeah. We definitely have enjoyed Seas of Havoc. I don't think it beats out anything else on my list, though.
Yeah.
I was selective. We could have kept going.
Well, we burned through the list there, so I think it is about time to go for a refill so that we don't extend ourselves. Welcome to our review of